this is a foundational transformation we see happening in the economy.
DeFi and blockchain are redefining business, the economy, and our society.
Hey, everybody. This is Megan Guy. We're here taping another fantastic episode of the reDeFined podcast. We have a great guest today. Leo Elduayen is here. He's the founder and CEO of Koibanx. And of course, I'm here with my fantastic co-host, Jeremy Almond. Jeremy, how are you doing today?
Hey, hey, hey. What's up, Megan? What's up? I'm psyched about this episode. This is actually one of maybe my favorite topics in all of the blockchain space. I'm talking about how real blockchain stuff's happening in the frontier areas of the world. So we're here today with my friend and an awesome entrepreneur, Leo, who has building a company that's in the blockchain space down in Latin America. What's up, Leo? Stoked to have you here today, man.
A pleasure to be here, Jeremy, Megan, and such an honor to share this space with you and excited for what we're going to discuss today. So
I want to start with actual real cases of real problems around the world. And you know, I think one of the things you and I bonded around is you've been in the middle of a bunch of infrastructure buildouts in Latin America in particular. And your backstory is a little bit of like what goes wrong in currency that leads up to maybe why Bitcoin and blockchain matter. And so could you give us, for those of us who are sitting in our plushy places, sitting in California, a little bit of like the backstory of Argentina, where you grew up, and why currency, stable currency, is actually problematic in many parts of the world?
Of course, it'll be my pleasure. So as you well stated, I grew up in Argentina. Argentina, it's a beautiful country full of smart people, like extensive land and landscapes. But we do have one historical main issue, which is our political / economic policy. Argentina is the country where we grew up. Saving, for instance, is in plaque index car plaques. Like you just buy a portion of a car because it indexes with time, so you protect yourself from inflation. It's the same country where we are closing this year with almost 200% interannual inflation December 23 to 22. So when you grow up with that context, you become created by necessity. It's like there's no
an
option.
You have a lot of sympathy for those in the U.S. that have been complaining about 9% inflation or whatever it was a year or two ago.
No, but it is true. And don't get me wrong. I definitely understand in terms of you define them like, you know, comfy, cushy positions. But most of us, we would love that comfy position. Although yeah. I must admit, like the thrill of building in LatAM, in Argentina in particular, but it gets to LatAM broadly, it's thrilling. Like when you say, let's start with Bitcoin, right? Which is the mother of the crypto space. Why is Bitcoin really used in countries like Argentina? Because you need an alternative to actually access some money because your pesos, the Argentinian pesos, which is our currency, loses value day to day. You also have a lot of political fixes or intended fixes to solve this root problem, inflation, economical and social problems, which most cases, it makes it even worse. Like, okay, since we don't want, we want as the political establishment to keep inflation low rates or at least not increasing, we prohibit the people to buy dollars from their bank accounts. So it's not that people will stop buying dollars. They just buy stables. They buy Bitcoin. Okay, but you as an importer, COMEX, import-export, you cannot access the dollar market because if you import stuff from abroad, you are putting the local industry in a disadvantaged place. So we don't want that as the government. No problem. I'll pay for my imports with Bitcoin or with other currencies, stable coins again. So people in Argentina and in LatAm, we use Bitcoin and cryptos for day-to-day payments, for savings, for cross-border payments. We even think of it. And if you go to some of the crypto meetups in Buenos Aires, one very recurrent topic is managing your inheritance with crypto. Like people is already thinking what they leave to their sons or to their grandsons in cryptocurrency. So it's really both complex and free. Like it's been a privilege for me to actually grow up in that context and to be able to help shape its hemp.
Can you talk a little bit about, like, when did you start to see this emerge? You know, is this, it's been a phenomenon of the last, you know, 5-10 years in the U.S. maybe. What did you see in Argentina?
Look, I started in early 2013. I was working at Mercado Libre, which is the largest company in Latin America. We're starting with payments, digital payments, e-wallets. And just by chance, I came across Bitcoin and a group of beautiful and incredibly smart degens, today the founders of Ripio, Bitso, RSK, really big hardcore Bitcoiners that got together to evangelize about the technology. This was November 2013. So I volunteered with them. I started learning. It blew my mind, of course, as most of us at the beginning, I didn't understand a single thing. With time, I grasped the idea that this was changing for our economy. This was changing for our peoples. And with the ups and downs the ecosystem has had, I will tell you, Megan, that since 2017, 2018, it when it's really picked off. You got the first issuances from regulators in 2015, 2016. You got the first institutional players. You got the exchanges established, the traditional financial institutions considering cryptocurrencies or at least tokenized assets. That's a whole other chapter, but it also comes into play. So I would say that in real adoption, we have like 6 years in.
Yeah, it's been growing really quickly and a little bit off the radar, I'd say, to a lot of folks in sort of mature markets in the U.S. where we take for granted stable currency. What is daily life like before 6 years ago? Where if you're just a normal person in any one of these countries and you have 200% inflation, like, what do you actually do? What was the alternative? Because people look at, you know, a little bit of the fluctuation that happens in Bitcoin and they're like, how could people transact? And it's hard for us here to see how could people transact because we're operating in a stable system.
Look, the most common one, it's called, it's a funny name, it's called arbolitos, which means little trees in Spanish, because they are informal financial institutions, illegal actually, that sell you cash in exchange, like dollar bills, in exchange for pesos. That's why the little trees name, because it's green. So you went into a gallery in Nueve de Julio or in any important avenue, you met with a guy that told you, Jeremy, you come from the university, it's like, back the door. And you're like, okay, really untrusty experience, especially if it's your first time. And you went with a bag of pesos, which is bigger and larger year after year, because exchange purchasing the same amount of dollars requires more pesos. And they gave you like a small amount of bills that were the dollars you accessed. And you left that gallery scared, or at least highly alert, because it was also very common for people to get marked. Like, hey, there's Jeremy. He's coming to buy 10K. Like, blue shirt, black car, pay attention. So you were like this. I actually went with my dad a couple of times, and we spread the bills. Okay, you take this, I take that one. We got a couple of fake dollar bills just in case we got robbed. Luckily, we never got robbed, but just in case someone approaches us, like, here's the money.
Yeah.
So that was what we used to do. And just for you guys to have an idea of how that evolved, these little trees, the arbolitos, put in place a delivery service, and they charge you like 2 or 3 basis points on the FX, and you got delivered to your house. But then you started thinking, like, now they know where I live, so you take them to the office or to a shopping mall. You got like alternatives. And one, if I may, one personal experience that for me, it's a good reflection of what we went through. At some point, the FX with your credit card abroad was not blocked. So you could spend dollars at the official rate in other countries, but not in Argentina, and you couldn't buy dollars. So we took a ferry to Colonia, which is a city in Uruguay, a neighbor country, which is 2-hour ferry. We entered a casino, we swiped our card, we got our chips. You didn't gamble, you just walk around, went back to the cashier, and you said, hey, I want to cash this out, American dollars, please. You took the dollars back to Buenos Aires in the ferry, hoping you didn't get caught at customs, and you could sell the dollars at twice the price you bought them in the casino. Eventually, even that got blocked. So when you show to the people something like stablecoin, or as you will state, Jeremy, like Bitcoin, digital from your bank account, from your e-wallet, you don't need to give even your entire financial history. You don't have to risk your personal security. That's a no-brainer. That's why it's so highly adopted.
So you know, you described an incredibly sophisticated response to an entirely broken system. And one of the things you and I bonded on was your experience in the moment that El Salvador kind of woke up as a nation. And so I'd love for you to maybe describe a little bit of like, what was this level of discussion, not only in Argentina, but now in El Salvador, a year and a half, 2 years ago, where they were really going through their own kind of internal mirror on how do we solve a broken financial system?
And in El Salvador, if I may, Jeremy, it's not only the financial system, but it's even more to your point when it comes to financial inclusion. El Salvador has almost 30% of its GDP that it's remittances. So how do you get money from the diaspora in the US and in Spain mainly back to the hands of people that need it in a not even a monthly paycheck, like a weekly wage? These guys depend on that money coming in. So I'm not going to name them, but we all know what I'm going to make reference to. All the remittances companies that take you $20 per transaction, 5% per transaction, when you present them with an alternative where that goes down to cents on the dollar, you actually transform people's lives. And despite all the criticism President Bukele has received in the past, time has given him reason, right? But in the past, he was highly criticized. And what this guy did so brilliantly is, despite Bitcoin and how it's increasing the El Salvador reserves overall, he put in place a national digital payments and savings system with Bitcoin as the Trojan horse. Like banking, you mentioned banking in El Salvador. Before 2021, it was 30% of the population was. Today, we are at 43%, and it's less than 2 years. Not a lot of countries grow at that pace with banking increase while you are complying with all the GAFI policies, blah, blah, blah. So what El Salvador did, it's personal opinion, right? But it's brilliant in a whole bunch of aspects. Financial inclusion, lowering down day-to-day necessities from the people. I always tell the same, like, he changed the country's brand with probably spending a third of whatever other countries spend. Like Costa Rica, just to name another one, they spend thousands of millions of dollars in putting in your head, this is the paradise. El Salvador, before Bukele, was the country of murderers, and today it's the country of surf and Bitcoin. Both things that you love a lot, Jeremy. And it costs them an investment that it's already paying off. So that's the brilliancy of what Bukele did. And people are supporting him like how they want. Like he's taking down the murder rate to almost zero. He's enhancing security and he's allowing what's most important for them, sending and receiving money. He lowered the cost down like 10 times. It's impossible that he has no 90% of positive image as he has, actually.
It's an amazing story because actually the very first episode that we shot was very striking. Our guest spoke about emigrating to the U.S. as a child and his parents not speaking any Spanish, or sorry, his parents not speaking any English. And so he talked about being 10 years old and having to go with his dad to, you know, the office of the company that shall not be named that you mentioned that processes a lot of remittances, and having to translate to his father all the costs and the fees and realizing that these very, very hard-earned dollars were going to turn into so much less money on the other end for their family that needed it. And so, you know, this is just an amazing example, I think, kind of what you're sharing.
Yeah.
Of how that pain is being transformed through blockchain through Bitcoin. Can you talk a little bit, Leo, about your company, Koibanx, and like how did you personally get involved there in helping to build some of the rails that have really facilitated that transition?
I founded Koibanx back in 2015 after I got in touch with this nonprofit organization that I told me for Bitcoin Argentina, which eventually became Bitcoin Latin America. My personal background is I'm a lawyer and a coder, so I have a sort of weird combination, I think. But my lawyer side is really active. Like, I love legislation and how it puts in place the incentives for the society. And when I started to understand Bitcoin, I said to myself, like, this has a tremendous amount of value to add. But I also don't believe that the status quo will actually blow up. Like, a lot of my colleagues, Maxi colleagues, they were like, the formal financial institutions will never touch this. And I was like, they won't touch it for the right reasons. I'll give you that. And I'll sympathize with them. But they will use it. And I think I always had that conviction. So I started with my colleagues and some of the initial investors thinking on how could we put infrastructure that made Web3 assets, started with Bitcoin and Ether back then and evolved to a bunch of other old cryptos and tokenized assets. How can we embed that in the traditional rails? And El Salvador, going back to Jeremy's point, was an empiric example, because what we were hired to do by President Bukele is, I want Koibanx to put the infrastructure in place so that the national banking system can't complain of Bitcoin usage. Like, I don't want them to have an excuse. I want them this to be seamless, not to say, no, but we need to manage keys and securities and we don't have the knowledge. Like, here's a company that's done this in three other countries, Mexico, Colombia, and Argentina. It's work. It's regulatory approved by other government bodies. Like, just use it. And that's how it happened. Like, we enabled holdings from banks and fintechs to be tokenized and integrated to the traditional financial system, payment system. Like, you could use crypto to pay at a merchant that doesn't even hold a Bitcoin address, or the other way around. Like, merchants, it's very typical for us that merchant networks in Argentina, for instance, they receive day-to-day pesos, but they get credited. The actual settlement takes place 3 days later. And again, 200% internal inflation. So taking a stablecoin position or even a Bitcoin position the same day at the same moment that payment is authorized, that has a lot of value without having to actually understand how the protocol works and making them or abstracting them from that complexity. So that's what we've been growing. Today we're working with 10 banks in the region, 3 governments, over 10 fintechs, like putting the rails to combine Web3 assets, crypto, ramps, licenses, to make it actually usable and not imposing our own brand, like allowing existing players to join this movement, which we all believe in.
You know, I took a trip maybe 2 years ago or so, right when the whispers of what was happening down there started. And quite frankly, the banks weren't terribly ready, maybe if I'd say it generously. They were very, very traditional, right? So they probably weren't even up to date to, you know, what you'd call US or European sort of infrastructure. And then all of a sudden, a mandate to maybe do a leapfrog, an entire generational jump. And so I had this experience right before the sort of law went out. I took another trip to El Salvador right after the law came out and a lot of the initial infrastructure you guys worked on. And I remember I brought one of my lead architects and I brought some of our executives down there. And we were going through the customs line. And my lead architect, who'd actually been working on blockchain code for probably 10 years now, was like walking through the customs line and he had to pay the like, whatever it was, equivalent of $10 to
yeah, you're charged a visa as American.
Yeah,
like
yeah,
a reciprocity visa.
And the customs officer was like, you know, whatever the equivalent of, you know, was X number of sats or whatever. And my architect was like looking at it curiously, like, there's no way this is going to work. Like, how broken is this technology? And the customs officer was like, scan the QR code and just go through the line. And he was like, wait, what? Like, I just got shown up by like a government officer to just like do a frictionless experience and move on. And so he scanned the QR code. It ran over Lightning, and he was pretty blown away in this magic moment experience as something that you thought was theoretical for 10 years was now used in practice at the core infrastructure layer of the government in the first moment you walk off the plane, and it just worked. And so I guess I'm curious what it was like, what it's been like for you over the course of a year to rapidly change a lot of the infrastructure down there. What's the behind scenes experience for us to be able to walk through a customs line that's now, quite frankly, more sophisticated than Silicon Valley in that respect?
Yeah, and Latin America, in this technology leapfrog that you're mentioning, which I agree, it also has an advantage. I must admit that, because you're at the point where in most countries you say, okay, what you already have running, it's already paid off. Like, you probably had the same tech stack for 10 years. Like, it's already done. There's no like constant investment that sometimes decision makers tell you, no, wait, but we spent $3 million last year on this. Like, let's make it last a little bit. In most cases, you're taking the infrastructure at a point where everyone agrees that there's no reason to actually keep it, but the political cost, because no one wants to be the one in charge of making that change. But here is my kudos to President Bukele. He said, fuck it. Like, there's not a choice. Everyone needs to change this. So you either change it or you are against the law. And I'm not going to be soft about breaking the law. So that's what gave us the actual entry. It's like, okay, Leo, we need to do this. The government has given you their blessing. You already have the tech. You don't need to rebuild it. That's something important. Koibanx, it's already turning 7 years old. So the first 2 to 3 years, going back to your question, Jeremy, what's a lot of try and mistake, you know? Like, at the beginning, we even did like self-management of the keys. You start learning, you get like, you're able to reuse. We shape the entire infrastructure as a platform to plug in, so there's no custom development at scale. That's what gave the context, like political pressure, infrastructure at a level where there's not a lot of pushback in terms of, no, let's use what's already in place, and our maturity point. Like, if the Bitcoin law had been passed in 2019, I need to be honest, probably we won't have been able to do it at the same quality as we did in 2021.
The difference in improvement, right? And that step change, like, you're talking about a system with an enormous amount of friction. And so upgrading to the current version is, you know, it's like moving from the rotary phone to like an iPhone, right? Whereas I think some of the more developed economies that we've talked about, and, you know, the US, there's a little bit of friction in the system and we whine about it, but like, it's so minor, right? It's like, my app's loading so slowly today. Like, and so I think that's the other piece probably that, you know, it gives the power to make that type of a change. And, you know, as you said, I think this is our first F-bomb that's gotten dropped in the reDeFined podcast, very appropriately. But like, it's easier to do that, I think, when the benefit is so much bigger.
And I believe that's what you just mentioned. It's key, like incentives. What's the incentive to do something? Like, for most of financial players in the US, a change this drastical requires like a belief, like a personal belief from the decision maker. In Latin America, in most places, not in all, right? But in most cases, there's an economic incentive to do so. Like, even cost reduction or new revenue streams building or market growth, like, there's a different landscape that gets in play.
On one hand, you can say, well, if you have sunk cost and you have incumbents, there's not the incentive to maybe move because the step change isn't as big. But on the other hand, like, there's a first mover advantage to, you know, sort of technology transformations to geos, right? So like, Silicon Valley is the way it is because it was part of the PC revolution. It was part of the internet revolution. And so it's created an enormous amount of, you know, sort of economic, you know, value creation, wealth, quite frankly. You know, I think you're starting with your company to see is beyond just even the payment infrastructure. There's other uses for these assets that some of these regions are starting to also pioneer. So like, you know, what's happening for, you know, bonds down there? What's happening for, you know, sort of real estate assets and tokenization? Like, are there other things that now get first mover advantage in these geos that get put on chain, let's call them, that these countries might literally be the first in the world to do it?
Recently, there's been a public announcement where the Colombian, Peruvian, Chilean, I think Ecuador as well. I might be wrong with Ecuador, but the three I mentioned before for sure are joining their stock exchanges. Why? Because liquidity in the end. At the end, it's all about liquidity. Markets, traders follow liquidity, investors follow liquidity, etc. Bitfinex moves annually more money than El Salvador stock exchange. Binance moves monthly more money than El Salvador stock exchange. Annually more than almost all stock exchanges in the country, with the exception of Brazil. So there's a play for the incumbency, not even for the Digens. This is no longer a Digen play, but it's curious how we both meet at the same point. Financial inclusion is one of the topics that you mentioned at the beginning of the podcast, Jeremy, and how much of these people that live week to week, paycheck to paycheck, can't actually access a $10 investment in real estate, in a dollarized title, whatever, or a dollar-linked title, but they can access and buy cryptos. What's the problem with cryptos so far? That with the exception of Bitcoin and maybe Ether and maybe some other one, but it's easy to scam these people because they're not educated in the matter. There's a lot of the boom when the market explodes, like every crypto promises to be the new Bitcoin. Of course, they will never be, but how to explain this to these people that have 30 minutes available per day to educate themselves because they are working again in a day-to-day, week-to-week basis. But if you get the incumbents, the status quo, to somehow take care of the regulatory part, properly manage or properly work, not work in their own interest, but actually put together a platform or a structure that allows these people to access a fraction of actual assets to protect their investments or their savings. And again, this has nothing to do with Bitcoin in the end. It has to do with Bitcoin in the sense that it's the same infrastructure, it's the same Web3 movement, and Bitcoin is the door opener. But going back to your question, there's an angle, there's an opportunity for other Web3 plays that are already taking initial steps, which I believe is going to be a huge driver of adoption the next 24 months, maybe.
The thing that's interesting there, again, when I think about pioneering, is just like, you know, Bitcoin and digital payments were pioneered there in the frontiers. One of the things Megan and I have talked a lot about with other guests on the show is a lot of the tokenization of other assets are generally where we're seeing traction in the mature markets are digital assets. So in gaming and things like that. But I don't think that's what you're talking about here, right? You're talking about real world assets. So maybe could you unpack that a little bit? Like, what does real world assets look like tokenized in Central America?
Look, you need to start with a point of centralization. Unfortunately, still, that's part of the play, but it's much better than what we have today. So I'm a farm. I take my coffee harvest, my soy harvest, depending which country you are, to the silo company, to the cooperative, to the point of centralization. Typically what happens, you get a warrant or some sort of legal document that says, hey, this is your certificate that you actually deposited your harvest. I'll take it from you. I'll sell it when I ever see feed, when the market. And that gives the farmer it takes a lot of power from the farmer. You need to work for this guy or this company just and believe him or her that it will be your own benefit. With this tokenization infrastructure that's entering into play, you get a token that represents how much grain or coffee, whatever you deposit. And these tokens, you can hold them in a wallet. What wallet? Well, now the incumbent say, hey, I might be interested in holding that. Like, I can offer that service to the mainstream. I already have 1 million simplified bank accounts. With the proper tech, I can also hold these assets. I might be interested in that. So you get a mainstream channel. And these farmers can actually use their tokens, similarly scanning a QR code or sending it to another bank address with the price of the day. Like, you don't need to pre-sale or to pre-arrange a number. Today, the price is up, so I want to use X amount of tokens to pay for a motorcycle or whatever. That's one of the ways that it's actually happening in reality. The other one, it's real estate that you mentioned it. This is most for rent. Like, tokenizing real estate for a living, it's not something that, for actual housing, it's not something that's picking up. But there's a lot of construction for offices or just renting options. And you are giving people the chance to say, if you validate your ID, if your source of income is it's clean or the amount is very low, like less than $100, you can actually send the money to the government institution, to the developer, to the fintech vendor. It depends on who commercialized it. And you get back a token. That token, no questions asked, gives you X percent of the rent in your own bank account or in your own wallet. So you're giving people the chance to actually access some saving instrument, which was not possible before. And here's what's, for me, it's beautiful. The government, the same government that initially rejected it because all of their processes were built for a risk, they should be honored. Now it's telling us, but this is much better. I can see real time. I can see who holds what. It's transparent. And we are like, duh, I've been telling you, but okay, it's a process, you know, it takes time.
Yeah, I mean, it's not unlike, I think, you know, some of the cases we've seen, even in developed economies, where things like art, like, you know, real estate, as you said, we're not quite there yet. But there are huge, you know, segments of the population, even in wealthy countries, that don't have access into certain types of investments. And, you know, we've talked with folks who are creators themselves and, you know, create art, create poetry. And the idea of the smart contract and the tokenization of those assets has completely unlocked new value streams and a new incentive, to get back to that word, for them to keep creating, you know, new art. So, yeah, it's a very, very powerful tool.
Well, the other thing that's cool is it's globalized, right? So it's like, you know, I was sitting in my favorite hipster coffee shop the other day, and, you know, I was looking at like single origin Colombian, you know, farmed coffee. And I was thinking, geez, like if we're talking about tokenizing the commodity or coffee farm or whatever, like all of a sudden, you know, even me and back in the developed world could get access to, you know, those commodities in ways that I wouldn't otherwise, right? So like on one hand, you might be accessing an art market that someone else hasn't, or somebody in the underbanked area could access a market that they hadn't. Or it could be like people back here, back at home, are actually accessing global markets that we wouldn't otherwise have exposure to, which is also super fascinating, right?
The coffee example, it's already taking place, both in El Salvador and in Colombia. And with the NFT as an instrument, like you buy a particular bag of coffee that gets delivered to your place or whatever. And I'm not much fond of NFTs, I must admit, but this is one of the use cases where I say, okay, I see the value behind it in the sense of the intrinsic value, you know, not just price speculation.
One area I'm really curious about, Leo, we don't get into politics too much, but because you're from Argentina, like, I don't know, something I'm personally fascinated, who don't normally study global politics, is like, there's a new president there who has a very different view on the world. And, you know, kind of back to this case, like, you know, he's made some pretty strong statements about tearing down the central bank and, you know, sort of creating a much more open market. You know, all of these things are generally friendly to, you know, Bitcoin and blockchain. What should someone like me in California, who's like roughly following it, you know, on Twitter for the first time, like, what the heck's happening down there?
Yeah, Millet, it's for me, is the birth of an era. Like, we alternated in left wings, right wing, center wing presidents. And you can see the trend in the region. Like, there's a moment in time where you had Kirchner, Lula, even in Colombia, someone like Petro, and then it shifted back to Bolsonaro, Macri, Piñera in Chile, Duque in Colombia. And now Argentina has broken the trend with Milei, as you well mentioned. He's a libertarian, but a real hardcore libertarian. He's been advocating for libertarianism even before he ran for president, like for the last 4 years. So it's not like he just put in a character for the elections. He's built a reputation in the space with that. And libertarians share a lot of the Bitcoinists at some levels, right? It has a lot of overlap, positive overlap, if you ask me. And the question or the similarities between Milei and Bitcoin are very common. He supports Bitcoin from a libertarian point of view. Like, it's legit. Why should I have a saying against it? Because usually politicians, I don't care, I'm not a politician. Like, if both parties come to an agreement, that's it, period. I believe that it's going to be flourishing for Argentina overall, but in particular for the crypto space. A lot of the stablecoin companies, which we all know here, are already, they've taken flights to Argentina to start to learn about the ecosystem because it's allegedly going to get bi-monetary policy, dollar, peso, Bitcoin is going to be an alternative. So as long as you remain between the boundaries of the laws, the position that Milei's team, because I haven't spoken directly with him, but that Milei's team gives you is, guys, if it's not prohibited, we'll allow it. And if it adds value, even more. So don't expect an answer from our side that clarifies that something that it's not explicitly prohibited, it's not prohibited. Like, he's changing the way we think about legal certainty. It's like before, you always have to ask, like, hey, this is not prohibited, but still, are you okay if I do it? And now the government posture is like, why are you asking? Go and build.
Yeah, I mean, this is a wild change, right? Like, you and I were exchanging, you know, sort of private texts right when it happened. And I was like, well, it's a crazy grand experiment because, you know, from the outside, it's like, you know, was there a culture in a government that's largely been atrophied through bureaucracy and all these things and inflation and sort of a death spiral? And then all of a sudden now you look and go, well, what you're describing is a culture of building again. Right? Like a culture of creation, which creates economic value. And then, you know, at the most fundamental level, you're right. At least he publicly has been, you know, a Bitcoiner. But what he has publicly talked about is broken money, right? And this goes back to your original start of the conversation. It's like anywhere in the world where inflation is rampant and the system is sort of bogged down by its own weight is an untenable system for the normal people. And you have somebody who's actually, as a trained economist, saying the money system is broken and you fix the money and you help fix the world. Like, these are radical thoughts for a leader, you know, and at minimum are parallel with, you know, some of the movement that I think, you know, true people who are in for the philosophy of blockchain are trying to, you know, help move an economy forward. So I don't know. It's exciting. We'll see what happens, but it's sure
no, I'm
exciting,
bullish.
Right?
Definitely bullish on him in Argentina. And going back to he has a phrase, if you Google it, you'll find it. He actually says, literally, translated, but literally, monetary policy and central bank issuing is the way or the scheme through which politicians rob the population. Because everyone is paying the inflation price, but then. So he hasn't closed the central bank. That's probably a stretch in his political campaign, but he can us hold back on all money issuing. So the central bank remains as a regulator, as a consultant, if you want, in terms of monetary statistics. It's a lot. Like, I don't know other country that has done that other than Ecuador probably 30 years ago.
We'll all be watching for sure.
Yeah. I mean, look, this has been for me, like, it's so exciting, right? Like, we're talking about real world change, you know, not just a bunch of hipsters in the internet, like speculating on something. I've been psyched. I think for us, like our team's been, thank you for educating us. Where can people find more info about you, man, and follow you, follow the company, and they want to know what's going on down there?
Well, Twitter and LinkedIn are probably our most active channels. At Koibanx, koibanx.com is a website. LinkedIn, you just can find us as Koibanx. My personal is Leo Elduayen, at Leo Elduayen, like my surname. The honor has been all mine, Jeremy, Megan. Like, as you probably can tell, I get easily excited talking about what we do. It's exciting. Like, we really enjoy the road. So what else can we ask?
Beautifully said. Thank you so much, Leo, for spending some time with us and for sharing your perspective. And we look forward to chatting with you next time.
All right, everybody. That's a wrap. We'll meet you on the next episode at reDeFined. Find us on YouTube, Spotify, Apple, and wherever the heck else podcasts exist. All right. Catch you in the next one, guys. Cheers.